Hello, welcome to Lincolnshire New Folk Movement, and I'm very excited today to talk to the man who is not my dad, and that is the question that gets asked to me all the time. It's the local legend that is Jon Newby. So thank you very much for joining me, Jon. And would you just like to tell us a little bit about your background, how you got into writing and playing music, and where you're at now and that kind of thing?
Yeah, I do just like to say this is the man that's not my son as well, because I get told all the time I've just been to see your son play. It's a bit of a laugh really, isn't it? So how did I get into it? I'm a singer. I just love singing, Jake. You know, just I can't remember a time I wasn't singing to myself or singing out loud somewhere. Just music in my head all the time, you know. So and gradually that got channeled a bit. I think a friend of the family came when I was probably about 7 or 8. Came round and said, "Oh, what a lovely voice little Johnny's got, he'd better join the choir." So there I was, duly marched down to Holy Trinity Choir, where I met the Hallam Mafia. I was there for a little while, but I didn't really enjoy it that much. And then I got a transfer up to the big church, St James's, and I never really looked back after that. I was one of those little probationers, I think they called them, before you joined the choir. You just got the robe and the ruff, but you didn't have the white surplus thing and all that. I don't know whether you know these things. And I actually sang a solo even at that stage. So I obviously there was something about what I did and the way I did it, I suppose, that was noted. And just went on from there, just singing. I played violin. Played, scraped away on a violin for a few years, a lot of years actually. And then because of that, I got sent for piano lessons. I still can't play piano.
Really?
I didn't like piano lessons. I love synths and noises they make, but I dabble. And then I don't know really, how did I get into the writing? I met a bunch of people when I moved to, at the time, what was called King Edward's School, it's called Kevis now, isn't it? I met a bunch of people there, some of whom I'd known previously from my primary school, and they were all into bands like Yes, Led Zeppelin, Floyd and stuff like that. I'd never heard of them. I was the guy that bought the Laughing Gnome and thought that was David Bowie's complete works, you know. And I really liked this music and this electric guitar. I'd never heard really, you know, we weren't really exposed to that in our household. My parents were probably a little bit older than most people's, you know, so I just got involved that way, really. We actually had a band before we ever had instruments. You know, we decided who was going to play what and that was going to be... Music was a massive deal then, you know, it was... there's so much music now, we forget, you know. I think there was probably one person at the grammar school played an electric guitar, and a couple of other guys were quite good on guitar. They just weren't the people doing it. So that's how I got into it, really. Bought a cheap guitar, saved me money up from, I used to do like the equivalent of Arkwright's grocery round on one of those bicycles. I think I got £1.20 a week, and I duly saved up £25, went on a bus to Lincoln, and bought myself a totally unplayable guitar. and started to teach myself from Bert Weed and Play in a Day.
I remember the first bass that I bought, and it was similar. The neck of it, I think, was sort of like that. Yeah, it was like a curved bow, and I've no idea how I played it. It was a silver Marlin. Yeah, bass.
So, it's difficult to buy an instrument like that now, isn't it? You know, even the entry-level instruments are really quite nice things. You know, they're playable, you know, without a doubt, compared to what you and me obviously learned on. So that's where I kind of started. And with it being slightly unplayable, you could put your hand under the strings at the 12th fret. So bar chords, I couldn't understand why I couldn't play bar chords. I also didn't understand in this Play in a Day book that if I learnt these chords and I strummed them exactly how it said, I can never understand why the tune didn't magically appear. You know, as a guitar player, as we now know, don't we? You play chords to support somebody singing. But I presumed if I strummed them in just the right way, somehow magically this tune that I didn't even know anyway would come out of the instrument. And it never did. So with that, I discovered you could get feedback, you know, with an electric guitar. And used to just spend hours just moving it around, getting different feedback. So really came into it noises, and because of the violin playing single note things as well, yeah, rather than playing chords. Got my next guitar and I suddenly realized why I couldn't play the chords and stuff on that one, you know. And then fairly soon formed a little band with people. We learned the songs, and then eventually you get in and you form your first proper group, don't you? You know, yeah, as a musician. I suppose I'd be about probably, I took guitar fairly late. I was probably about 15, nearly 16 when I started on guitar. So a couple of years sort of playing about. I was probably around about 18, maybe 19, and that when I got my first band together. And we used to, initially, we just used to jam at the cinema. Andy Dalton was the bass player and his dad was the manager of the cinema.
Ah.
And so we actually used to practice behind where the screen is now at the cinema.
Oh, really?
The upstairs one, because it's been split into several, hasn't it? But and we could leave the gear there and everything. And not only that, nobody knew where the terrible racket was coming from, so they couldn't stop us playing. And we just play for hours up there. You know that buzz when you're in a little band like that, and you write your first song that you think is really good and you just play it, and then you think, God, that was good, we'll play it again, and then 14 plays through later, you know, you want to play it again and again and again, and that, just that enthusiasm. That was a band that, and I think we were called the Shrinking Spires to start with, named by a friend as we were walking uptown. Yeah, so we said, oh, we ought to call ourselves the Spires. And for some reason, he said the Shrinking Spires. So it began. So that was it, really. Paul Barrett on drums. And so it's basically a three-piece band, guitar, bass and drums. And we wanted to be sort of like the Police or Elvis Costello, that sort of time. Background songs. Lynn joined us on backing vocals. So there were four of us then. And we sort of played a lot in Grimsby. Always in fear of our lives, really, in Grimsby. I don't know, you know, there's some lovely people in Grimsby, but when you're not used to Grimsby, you know, for being brought up in the relative safety of Louth, it's a bit of a scary place, isn't it? So escaping with your life was always quite a good, meant the gig had been quite good. So yeah, I did that, and then gradually we kind of got better and better, did a bit of recording. And amongst other people, we asked, at the time, a local celebrity, I suppose, Bram Tchaikovsky, to come and produce us. And we went to a little studio in Ragby that the guys who owned that set the Chapel studio up after we'd sort of been there. And we just went and did some demos, and Bram produced us, and Bram's manager heard the demos, and I kind of got one of those awkward phone calls, you know, after he'd heard them. We'd been there a few times and done demos, and I got an awkward phone call. Was, we like the songs, but we don't like the band, from, you know, a guy, London manager, as it were, you know. So, John, I'd like you to sign on the dotted line, but I don't want the rest of the band.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh.
Which,
did you do
was
that?
A bit of a hard. Well, I have to quantify it, is that we'd been playing for a few years, maybe 2 or 3 years, and I think it got to the point where Andy just left his bass guitar at the cinema all the time, never practiced really. Mm-hmm. It's a great bass player, and I played with him later and love him, and I'm really sad with what's happened to Andy now with his stroke and everything, and that is really sad. But at that point, he was losing interest, I think. We went and had a sort of chat to Lynn. She wasn't obviously particularly happy, but could see that, you know, if that's the offer that's on the table. I say we because I'm obviously not a complete songwriter. I write songs with a guy called Ian Campbell, didn't actually play in that band, but we used to write songs by post in those days, not on Zoom. He would send his lyrics through the post, and I would send him a cassette tape back of the, you know, the songs and stuff.
Yeah.
Well, that's kind of how I got into it, really. And we signed a deal with the manager. Did some recordings down. I'm trying to think where we did them now. We didn't initially do recordings. He bought us a four track, so we were doing four track demos on those reel to reel machines.
Yeah.
About hear things through the hiss. We got quite good at doing these little demos and stuff. And then eventually we wrote a song and he said, oh, well, that's the one, we'd better go and record it. So we're a couple of Charlies from Leith, tootle off down to London, you know, and we're in a studio down in London, nothing particularly famous or anything. And we've got a drummer comes in, fabulous drummer, a guy called Phil Towner. Absolutely brilliant player. We layer up all the tracks and everything, and then we go to a studio that was just beyond our comprehension, really. We used Trevor Horn's studio.
Oh, wow.
Farm East, and they just got in the first SSL solid state logic mixing desk, computer controlled by a computer the size of a wardrobe. And the actual, it was so smart that in order to set all the controls back to where you'd left them, the faders would move automatically, but every other control had to be moved manually until the little line disappeared. So imagine all those little knobs had to be moved. It took about an hour to set it back up, and then in theory it should sound the same as when you walked out the studio.
Oh, right.
So we found ourselves there, and we got... a guy called Matthew Seligman, who used to play with the Thompson Twins when they were a band. Before they became famous as pop stars, they were quite a cool band. So he came and played bass on it. Probably the person who's ended up being the most famous was a woman called Anne Dudley, came and played a Moog bass part on it. And she was in Buggles, and she's written countless film scores and had BAFTA awards, and I think she even got a what's it, you know, the big one, the big Hollywood award, an Oscar.
Oh, really?
For a musical score. So we had some absolutely, you know, amazing people just came in, and we recorded a song called Away From This Town, and then we went round sort of selling that, really, with our manager. We went round, visited a few record companies. Did some further demos. We did Manchester Square Studio for EMI. We, you know, with the Beatles. You know that picture of there's two Beatles albums, aren't there? One's red and one's blue, and they're on the stairs.
Oh, so yeah.
That's where they were, the Manchester Square offices, and there's a couple of studios in there, and we went, did further demos for them. And eventually we signed with a little recording outfit where the head, the guy was, had been head of CBS Records, which were a big record label back in the day, wanted to set his own label up. And so he was in the building, and we went with Regard Records, of all people, who probably never heard of. Most famous, I should think, for one of the other acts, Hazy Fantasy, which you're probably
Yeah, I've heard of Hazy Fantasy.
John Wayne is big leggy, and I think they were the first. They have the dubious distinction of being the first act to simulate a sex act on Top of the Pops. quite colourful. And so we were going to be pop stars. You know, we were there.
We were pop stars.
Well, we weren't, so we signed this deal, and they put the single out, and they said, well, we think we're going to have to work to get radio play and stuff, so we'll press up a few promo copies, and it's the death of a thousand bands, this is, really. And they duly did that, and within about a week we were on a on a Radio One program, being, I think Radio One's Round Table, I think they called it, where they reviewed the latest leases.
Oh, yeah, released.
So we had Passed the Duchy to the Left-Hand Side, you know, the musical youth were on the same week. They did really well, didn't they?
They did.
Yeah, and we got a great review, you know, from that, and literally bang, the next week we were being played on Radio One. You know, probably one week we were not particularly on radio. We were on Radio One then, but I think we were 80th most played record in the UK.
That's so pretty good.
Which is not a bad position to be in. We weren't in any charts ever, because nobody could go and buy one.
That's a flaw.
They only pressed up, I don't know, about 20 or 30 copies for, and by the time they wanted, you know, by the time they were in a position to maybe get them, then the radio play had evaporated, because it's all to do with where you are, isn't it, in the charts. So, you know, we played it a bit. Is it in the charts? Do people like it? It's not in the charts. No, they don't. So you all go backwards then. Got some interesting reviews. From the NME, who are very cruel, aren't they, the NME?
Famously, yeah.
Away from this town and the further away the better was our first review. And for our second single that we put out, we ended up with a bunch of other bands being not something enough to be Kajagoogoo, which were a very pretty band of boys at the time. And we were too ugly to be Kajagoogoo. That was the review of our single.
It's like those reviews in Spinal Tap, isn't it? With like Shark Sandwich.
So we kind of did all that. And then it was a bit like Spinal Tap, really, because that was going down. We went in some fabulous studios. We went in Britannia Row, the Floyd studio. We went Psalm West, which was like a cavern, you know, one of those places they do orchestras. It's a bit weird standing in something that size with your Marshall amp and your guitar, and there's the window halfway up the wall, you know, so that they can look over the orchestra, and they're all up there with desks. Hello, it's me here. So we kind of did all that, and then there were rumours that we might get a tour with the Eurythmics.
Ooh.
But that never happened. And then we got a bit fed up with our record company, so we parted company. And our manager decided that he wanted to be like our record company come whatever. And we did get on some, we played a lot of clubs and things down in London. You know, most of those small clubs, we didn't actually play the Marquee, as Still Life was the band. We didn't actually play there, but most of those other places, Rock Garden, all those central London gigs, a lot of student unions we played. And we finally got a few dates. We played about 5 or 6 dates with Culture Club on a tour. So we played Sheffield City Hall, Oxford Apollo, Ipswich Gourmont, all those sort of 2,000-3,000 seaters, that sort of size, which is a little bit unnerving when you used to play in the upstairs at the Woodman. you suddenly realise, whoa, there's people up there as well, you know. And it's amazing when you're on stage how close they are. You know, when you're in the audience, the stage is miles away, isn't it? But when you're on stage, it's like, whoa, my word, they're all on top of you. They really are. That was a great experience. And then following a pucker pie incident in the back of the car, that was the end of the band. Two of them fell out, and that was it. Over a pucker pie. Well, one of them nearly got the pucker pie in the face. So, you know what bands are like. It's like having children, isn't it, really, sometimes. Maybe it depends who you play with, but... It can be,
yeah.
that was rock and roll history, really. So, and then since then, I've always played. I had another band down when I moved down to London and stuff, and just played in bands and written songs. And Ian and myself just when we were in London, we just wrote songs and sort of worked with, worked them up and played them, and we've got quite a catalogue of stuff really now.
So with your songwriting, do you, because the stuff you put up now on SoundCloud and things like that, stuff you put out is obviously much more acoustic. Do you approach your songwriting from back then in the same way as you do now? Is there like a process you go through with it, or is it evolved over time?
I don't think it's evolved. It was you. I tell you what, it kind of used to be, because we were in the very early days. We were in the same room together, and we were lucky enough to have, a few years of being full-time musicians, really, to a couple of years, 2 or 3 years. And so sometimes we would just get a bit of an idea going on a four track. And Ian would write some words and I'd put it to it. But I think as time has gone on, and the distance, and before, we've not tried Zoom or anything like that, before those sort of things existed, I think it's very much become, I've got a demanding dog, as you can see.
What's the dog called?
Noodles. Well, there's two here, actually. Noodles.
Noodles.
No, she won't.
Noodles.
Hello, look, you can say hello. Well, I'm too big for the. Come say hello. Whoops, here we go.
Hello, Noodles.
The other one, look. I can't see them because they're black, but I'm being mobbed. Look, go away. Songwriting. I think I very much approach it from the lyrics. It's
Okay.
the way that I kind of work. If you put some words in front of me now, I could be able to sing a song, and it wouldn't be very necessarily a very good one, but I can immediately see some sort of tune or whatever to it. So I'd probably write with possibly a guitar in hand. So I think it has changed. Yeah, I think I've gone more that route. Possibly before, like we were lucky enough to have one of those early. Since you could actually play chords on before, there used to be one note. We had a Prophet 5 synth, and just sometimes the sounds inspired me. Like you play something, oh, what a great sound that is, and you play like a little run or a few chords, and that would inspire something more. Whereas now, yeah, definitely lyrics first.
Do you, when you sort of say it about having the tune, is that tune sort of in your head, or does it come from tootling around on the guitar? Or a
I
bit of
think
both?
it's the two. I can't really quantify that. I've probably got a guitar, and I'm probably, but I'm almost doing two things. I've almost got an idea of a tune, and does that fit with? I don't know quite how that process happens. It's just in the moment, isn't it? I don't know how you do yours, but so sometimes it could come from guitar, but mainly the focus is definitely the words.
Yeah, I think when I'm doing stuff, like quite often I tootle around and then find something I like, but other times I've got a really clear idea of something in my head and I'm spending ages going, that's not the right chord, what is it then? And trying my fingers going all over the place and just sort of like going, well, is it that one? I physically can't do that, but that sort of thing.
I think open tunings are great for that, aren't they? Because some open tunings allow you to kind of. I wrote one song that I had to write the tuning down, because as I was writing it, I was actually altering the tuning to think, because I couldn't reach. So I thought, if I do that, that gives me that note. And in the end, actually, I simplified it, and it's an open E major chord, but it wasn't at the time, and it was played slightly different. But when I've gone back to it and relearned it, I realised it could be played like that as well. But they're great because they probably sound good with just one finger on the guitar sometimes, don't they? And they're suggesting maybe lots of different. There's lots of different notes you could sing over the chords, because they're interesting chords anyway. They're not just major or minor.
Yeah, I've not mucked about much with different tunings, and I think it's one of those basically because I'm too lazy. I can't be bothered to tune my guitar and then retune it again. I'll just leave it as it is. Yeah, I should actually pull my finger out a bit there.
when I first did it, I found it quite liberating because I hadn't messed about with them a lot, and it seemed a lot freer and more intuitive. You just sort of plonk your fingers and see. So I'm not thinking, if I'm playing guitar in a normal tune, I'm thinking that's an E major, that's a D, that's a C, that's a G. If I'm playing in an open tune, I'm just thinking, well, if I plonk my fingers there, it sounds great. And if I put them there, I'm like, ah, yeah, well, all this shape will move, just move up and down and sound amazing. And so that, I think it's a strange thing. It sounds more intricate than it is, but it's probably easier to play.
Yeah, I bought myself a slide a while back. It was, that's open tuning, so doing that. So I should tinker about more with that. I was thinking as well, because obviously you've got this huge amount of experience and that kind of all that going back to being in London and the single having a single with that kind of airplay on Radio One is not an easy thing to achieve, is it? That's actually quite an accomplishment, and I'm really shocked that your record label didn't do the one thing that a record label is famous for doing, which is making physical records, you know.
I think it's a fairly typical story if you talk to people. And I think we were actually lucky because I've spoken to some people who signed deals, got an advance. And when the parting of the waves took place, because obviously all the options are on the side of the record company, you've got no choice. Your life could be the next 5 years with this record label and on this deal. But theirs is, well, we'll put the single out, and if we don't like it, you can go. But we actually parted company and left them, and I've heard of people who've had to pay their advances back.
That's awful, isn't it? Well, it's such a and thinking about that, what sort of advice do you? I mean, I don't. Maybe you do give advice to your students and things like that because you teach a lot of people guitar about getting into the music business. What are some of the pitfalls and?
I don't really teach. I'm not really teaching at that level, to be honest. I teach the kids I teach to play guitar are mainly primary school kids, so 7 to 11 year olds. So we're not really thinking about contracts and signing stuff. And then I guess, my older pupils tend to be ones that have gone on from there. Secondary school age to go into university. So I've not really come across any that would be in a position of signing contracts, to be honest.
What advice would you give though to people starting out, so 16, 17 year olds, writing their own songs, thinking about putting stuff out there? What are some of the mistakes or good decisions do you think that you've made that helped you get to that point, which was
I think if you're talking signing contracts like that, you need to speak to a solicitor and see what's in it, and you need to speak to somebody who understands music contracts. And you shouldn't be afraid, because you're not normally very rich when you're that sort of age, and at the time I think, well, we know what solicitors cost. I can't remember what our solicitor's bill was for us to sit with a solicitor with a can of beer in his hand, telling us it was a few £100 by the time we'd finished, but we got our manager to pay the bill. So if people are that interested and they have, they're obviously pretty reasonably well off people, then don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to ask. If somebody's interested in you, don't be afraid to ask them for something that affirms that interest. One of the things we asked for before we ever signed a contract was some way of recording our songs, which he duly delivered. And when we came to find the solicitor, he sort of gave us a he actually gave us a list of solicitors. And we chose one, and he paid for it. So,
I think that team around you as well, because you look on Fresh on the Net and stuff like that, which got loads of advice for people, is talking about getting a team because we can't all be good at everything, can we? If you see what I mean. And so promotion and marketing of yourself. I think some of these really mega successful acts like Madonna and Lady Gaga, it's not just the music, they've got that they've got an expertise in marketing themselves.
It's a whole package, isn't it? The biggest thing really is, and the thing that we never had, was really a great identity. So I think what you have to be as a, if you look at people like that, they get themselves in the news one way or another, don't they?
The meat dress.
And they do it, you know. They are focused. They know exactly what they want. They're not afraid to ask for what they want, but they know why they're doing something, you know. I'm sure Oasis knew what they were doing, you know. The Sex Pistols knew what they were doing when they were effing and blinding on TV programs. They were creating media attention.
Yeah, I think that's very true, because there's so much, because one of the differences between now and back then, so sort of when I was doing stuff, is that availability of recording and distributing yourself. You know, there's so much you can do just off your own back now, but all that side of it, which means that there's loads and loads of stuff out there, isn't there? Like you said at the beginning, it used to be quite a rare thing for somebody to be in a band or be musical, but now it's much more I've forgotten what the word is, but anybody can access it. Democratic,
more abundant, isn't it? And I think the quality of it as well. You know, the quality of the recordings, the sort of quality you can just get in, sat in your own room recording. You'd have had to spend hundreds. I know you spend money on the equipment, but you'd have had to spend a lot of money in really posh studios to get anywhere near the sound quality you can now get in your own little back room.
Yeah, it's really true. I think that, and it's really exciting that, but I think to be able to cut through it, you know, because there's so many people, I think that branding, I've been thinking more about that recently, about how do you create an identity? And I think that's really important for artists, acts, especially when they're starting off, is to think about, yeah, you're not, it's not just your music, it's the whole package, isn't it, really?
It is, yeah. It's single, and it's wanting to do it. My other problem, I think, is I'm a bit of a musical butterfly. You know, one minute I've got my Les Paul through a Marshall stack, you know, giving it large, and the next minute I'm playing some gentle acoustic song, you know, and then I'm messing about with synths, and so I mean, you I think quite a few years ago you were a bit kind of didn't know you. I think I played some charity do that you brought on. You did some great work up at the King's Head.
It was ages ago.
Ages and ages ago, a long time, and you said you'd looked at my SoundCloud and you'd no idea what we were going to play from looking at my SoundCloud. You didn't have a clue, because it's all over the place, you know, and if you're trying to be an artist, it would be a complete waste of time, wouldn't it, you know, because then people would go, well, what do? They do this, they do that, they do, you know, oh my God, they do that as well, oh my word, and then they've done this horrible cover of a song, or I mean... So, yeah, you've got to have your branding and your identity.
Yeah. Yeah, I struggle with that. I'm a bit of a butterfly, sort of like trying all different things. Now, I was thinking as well, because you obviously play out loads, you know, when you can. And you're involved in Badger Fest quite a lot, weren't you? And with opening and the closing show. Yeah, the sing-along. I was just wondering what some of your favourite acts from Badger Fest over the years. Just name-check a few people.
Name-check a few people. Well, obviously your band, and you know, the name has gone off the top of my head with Holly. What were you called?
The Barbs.
Barbs. I thought you were great. I thought you were great fun as well, because you all dressed up in all the gear. I thought that, I tell you what was a great success was Martin Stebbins and Nick's band, the country and western band.
Yeah.
Martin came to me as somebody who wanted to learn the guitar, you know, pretty late in life to start an instrument. And managed to get himself, you know, from strumming a few chords to fronting a band and not making a bad job out of it, you know?
They were really good.
Yeah, so I thought, I always liked them. I just, there's so many, aren't there? Vicky Clayton played at a couple. She's a fabulous performer. I don't know if you caught her at all.
I'm not sure. I recognise the name, so I might have done.
She's played with Cropperty Folk Festival and all those sort of places. and played with some great bands as well. But she came, she's a wonderful performer. Trying to think of other acts really that have been there. There's too many to mention, Jake. There really are. It's just a wonderful, and the great thing is, well, it's just lovely sometimes to see people who are just starting out, isn't it? We saw Holly Humberstone there, didn't we, before she's really taken off now, hasn't she?
Yeah, in the United States as well. Yeah,
Yeah.
she's I bet they've printed her records up.
Yeah, I bet they are, yeah. Maybe she's probably not too ugly to be Kajagoogoo, is she?
They should get that on a t-shirt. That's good. Yeah. That's the brand to have. Just to explain to everybody who doesn't know what Badger Fest is. Badger Fest is a private festival which John and a load of people very kindly put on and organized and invited different people to come and play. There was like two stages, weren't there? So yeah, it was really wonderful. It ended never to come back in 2019, is that right?
Once, we decided never to do it again, and we were quite lucky, really, weren't we? Because otherwise, we'd have been trying to do it last year, and that would have been a no-no. But there's a little bit of talk of maybe doing it again. So,
Yes, I would love it if you did. It would be so good because it really was. It meant a lot to a lot of people, I think.
I think more than a private, it was a bit like a festival, wasn't it? But it was never anywhere near as rammed as a festival. It was more like a big private party. It was like the party maybe we'd all have liked to throw in individually, but didn't have the cash to do. But when you all put, a bit of cash in each, then you can hire in a big PA, because that starts to make the difference, doesn't it? If everything's
Yeah.
mic'd up and it sounds good, that's the first thing, if it, and so yeah, so just that injection of cash and stuff. And it really worked, yeah.
I think it's great as well that one of the things about Lincolnshire is we don't have a lot of venues that are accessible in that kind of mid-range, so
Yeah.
there's lots of pubs and things that will put you on. I'm very grateful for all those. And then you've got the engine shed and it's like, well, hang on a minute, what's in the middle there? So it was a great opportunity to play that kind of mid-size venue, and it was like a proper.
Yeah, there is a kind of venue that's missing at the moment, isn't there? Because at one time, as I say, when we supported Culture Club, they had Karma Chameleon out. So they were a big act and well known. They'd had a few hit singles, but they were playing, 2,000, 3,000 seats. Whereas nowadays, they'd have been playing Wembley, wouldn't they?
Yeah.
And so, and those that sort of theatre, big theatre size of venue is disappearing as well. Off tours, definitely.
I think it's it's just the marketing, because the operation costs, I think, start, everything's cheaper, isn't it, the bigger it is, but that means you can only book a narrower field of acts, so it's quite hard. You've got to make quite a leap to get there, really. But yeah, right. They were my main questions that I had for you, but I do have some quick fire questions for you, John.
Worried about these because I've seen them and I'm not sure whether I'd want it to go up the mountain or be with the sharks.
That was a tough one. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, here you are. These are your questions. So the first one, and I want you to think carefully about this. Which animals have the best nose?
Well, here we are. Look at this nose here. It's got to be dark.
The dog's nose. Is it just because the dog's there, or if they weren't here, would you pick something else?
Very upset if I chose another animal, wouldn't she?
She'd smell it out. Ah.
Yeah.
Right. The next one is, if you had to give up one for the rest of your life, would you give up toast or pasta?
Definitely pasta.
Pasta. Do you not like pasta?
No, I like pasta, but I'm an absolute peanut butter addict. So the thought of not having my toast and my peanut butter on it would just, that would be the end of the world, really.
I think I would miss toast more than I miss pasta. I mean, I eat quite a lot of pasta,
Yeah.
but toast is just brilliant. I had toast this morning with Marmite on. Absolutely fantastic.
Oh, I see that. Have you tried it with Marmite and peanut butter?
Well, we can't have peanut butter in our house because two of us, not me, but my partner and one of my sons is allergic.
Ah, right.
And yeah. I miss peanut butter.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I might come round to your house when all this has died down. Right, and the last question is just a general one. Have you ever, or would you ever, jump off the top diving board in a swimming pool? You know, the really, really high one that's concrete.
Yeah.
Have you done that?
Yeah, there used to be a swimming bath on Scaffer Road. I don't know what that is. Is that about 10 metres or something, the top one?
Probably, or 100 maybe. It always looked very high.
Yeah, I wouldn't go that far, but yeah, I've jumped off that several times, and I'm quite a good swimmer as well. So, yeah, I wouldn't have any issues with that, I don't think.
Could you do a tuck and roll or anything?
No, I'd not be doing that.
just off.
I couldn't do a tuck and roll on the carpet. You know? I'm not athletic.
I don't think I could do it. No, not me. Right. Well, no. I don't like heights much, and I'm not a very good swimmer. So, there's a combination.
That's a good reason for not doing it, then.
Yeah. It is. Yeah. Well, thank you ever so much for joining me, John. I've really enjoyed that. I learned loads of stuff. That's all very interesting.
It's a pleasure, Jake. Thank you.
Oh no, I forgot to invite you to send me this beforehand. But if I will put a song on at the end, one of yours. So what song of yours would you like me to stick on at the end of this?
If I send you one, it'd be called Tired of Dancing. It's I've just reworked it, actually, literally hot off the press. It's just been entered into a geriatric music songwriting competition called Talent is Timeless. They didn't think of the acronym when they named the group. But yeah, which has been a real eye-opener. It's for old people like me to, write songs. But they've had a Facebook page, and some of the music that people have posted on it is just out of this world, really. So it does just show that, yeah, talent is timeless and probably matures a little bit with age even.
I hope so. Okay. Well, thanks ever so much for joining me, John, and we'll put your song on after this. You take care and have a good afternoon.
Yeah, you too.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Funny how the night can play tricks on you. Changing things I thought I knew. But when we touched and when we kissed, we were like strangers falling in love. I'm tired of dancing. Turn my back on the crowded room. I'm tired of dancing. All I wanna be is with you, yeah, you. Heaven help the lost and the lonely. Trapped inside their noisy worlds. They can dance and they can shout, but they can't catch us falling in love. I'm tired of dancing. Turn my back on the crowded room. I'm tired of dancing. All I wanna be is with you. Standing so still, see the shape of a dancer. Everything moving so slow. Shadows and silhouettes slip sliding past her, moving with nowhere to go. Falling in love. Funny how the night can play tricks on you. Changing things I thought I knew. But when we touched and when we kissed, we were like strangers falling in love. I'm tired of dancing. Turn my back on the crowded room. I'm tired of dancing. All I wanna be is with you. I'm tired of dancing. Turn our backs on the crowded room. I'm tired of dancing. All I wanna be is with you. Just you. Wanna be with you, just you, just you.